Hello and a warm welcome to GT Asia. It's rounds 5 and 6 of the series, and we are in Japan. Beautiful Okayama Circuit, the Okayama International Circuit, deep in the forests of central Japan. We're in the west side of Japan, about 150 kilometers from Osaka. Here is the circuit, 3.7 kilometers in length with 13 corners. It's tricky, it's technical, and it's tight. Just the one big long straight at the back of the circuit, and it's certainly going to be a challenge for our GT Asia cars. Jonathan Green and Steve Martin bringing you the action from Okayama Circuit. And Steve, as we look at the championship, it's beautifully poised, actually. Davide Rizzo and Anthony Liu leading the championship after Thailand, a very successful Buriram for them, getting ahead of the Bentleys of Jonathan Venter and Sean Thong, who caught out last time out. We'll talk more about that. Marchie Lee is in fifth place with 41 points. He and Thong going a very good job so far and looking to do more again. Vuitton just behind them. Adelaide Fong is the man I'm looking at this weekend because he has been fast all weekend long with the Bentley. But as you can see, just 36 points, him and Andrew Kim, with work to do as we hit the fifth round of this prestigious GT series. Steve, the weather has been hot. We've had a lot of rain in the district. We've had a lot of rain in Asia, full stop, over the last few weeks, and particularly here in Japan. And when we arrived on Wednesday, Thursday, there was a lot of rain still around. And talking to Adelaide Fong, who's in the car right now and ready for this first stint in pole position, it was one of the concerns, certainly in the early sessions of practice, that the track was rubbering in. It's taking some time to rubber in because of the rain in previous.
Yeah, absolutely, Jonathan. They had a huge downpour the week before we arrived here at in Okayama, and the track was very green. There was no rubber, not a lot of vehicles or have been on the track during the week, and the GT3 cars were basically the first cars to get on the track. So a lot of the drivers were complaining about that lack of grip, and they've been working hard on the setup and you know, trying to find the grip. Some of the guys have, but there's still a few guys with question marks over the grip. They've got less grip here than what we've normally had at different circuits that we've been to, so expect to see a lot more wheel spinning and slides than usual.
And the weather has changed actually in the last hour or so here in the hills above Okayama, because above Akko, the city with which we are staying at the moment. But it's just clouded over. I don't think it's going to rain in our 50-minute race. And of course, compulsory pit stops for all competitors as we look at a man I'm looking very closely at, Carlo Van Dam, the Dutchman who pretty much makes his home Japan and has raced here probably more than any other driver outside maybe Ketasawa.
Yeah, you've got to think that Van Dam in the 458 Ferrari, the Singer car, is going to have a good opportunity to get a great result here. He had the opportunity to win last time out in Buriram, but that went astray. But I think that here this weekend, with his experience in Japan and this circuit, that he's definitely one to look for. Alex Jung is also another driver that's gone extremely well this weekend, Jonathan.
Yeah, and Alex hasn't had a good run of it lately, but the Audi seems to suit this circuit. They've had a few problems just getting the front of the car to grip a little bit. But now that they have, or at least over the practice sessions, it's improved. Alex Jung is another man who actually needs a good result from GT Asia, and I'm expecting him to certainly be one of the major factors in this race. It's all going to be, in my opinion, down to the start. We talked to Adelaide Fong, the man you're looking at on the left-hand side of your screen in the Bentley, who is pole position, and of course Bentley took their first win here last year with Ketasawa. He too is in this race. As we look at the starting grid, it's a very interesting starting grid because Fong will line up alongside Liberati in the Lamborghini and the FFF Racing by ACM Lamborghini, really on the charge. We've mentioned Van Dam, he and Jung on the second row in third and fourth place. Oh Young and Rizzo. Oh Young, of course, the champion, struggling the Porsches, it seems, here, which is a bit of a surprise. We expected them to come forward. Rizzo and Liu, of course, also looking for BBT to come forward. Venter, Sauer, pole position for round 6. And then Sugden and Lester. Now, Jono Lester coming into the championship this weekend, as is Christer Johans of Germany. In 10th position, he's teaming up with Kubrazak Butikorn. And also coming into the championship, George Vanecker and Morecambe, two Aussies. I'll let you explain, given that these are your countrymen. And also we've got Jimmy Bruni back in the fold with Mock.
Yeah, absolutely fantastic to see those guys in. Thong and Lee, of course, in the Phoenix Audi R8 as well. But the Australians, good to see them here. They've made their entrance in the Aston Martin. Of course, the team bought a couple of Aston Martins off of Darryl O'Young's Craft Bamboo team last year. And they transported those two cars down to Australia. And the Aston Martin that they were racing in Australia, they bought here to compete in Okayama this weekend. And it looks like they're going to be heading to Fuji Speedway in a couple of weeks' time as well. So good to have the Medeki Stone Motorsport team here this weekend.
Well, we're looking now from turn four down towards turn five. This is the longest straight. They'll get up to speeds of over 230k down this long straight. And this is a very important part, not only because it's straight, but at the end of it is the best overtaking place.
Yeah, and the thing about this circuit that is a lot different to the other two circuits we've been to this year is this is a lot tighter and smaller with lower top speeds and a lot tighter corners. So I think, you know, we're going to see a different type of action to what we're normally used to, Jonathan. And if the Porsche is going to go good, I think this is the weekend that we could see it start to, later on in the race, and definitely due to the lack of the grip, get some decent results. But have a look at the clouds up above, as you mentioned before. I wouldn't be surprised if that comes into play.
This is a circuit that's been around for a few years. It's old school. Everybody describes it just as old school, which is it's fast. It's got a lot of undulations in terms of fast. I say it's got some fast mid-speed corners, but it's tight, as you can see, especially with these big cars like the Bentley and the Lamborghini. It's going to be an interesting start with these two on the front row. And let us not forget, if you saw the whole season, Korea was a similar affair with Fong and the Lamborghini alongside each other, and it came to blows for Lamborghini, and they got in a lot of trouble for causing an incident there, and they're hoping to avoid that. And as you can see, getting into formation now, and this is key to the race because it is a tight track. There isn't a lot of places to overtake, and if we are in a good formation side by side with a car length between each, which does look good at the moment, Fong leading them now towards the start of this a 50 minute race with a compulsory pit stop. When those lights to your top left go out, we will be racing here in Okayama, round five of the series. Bentley versus Lamborghini. We go green. Good start from the Bentley, number eight there, but it's a better start from Adley Fong. He gets touched from behind. Hands onto it nearly. Yeah, well, that was a big moment. Oh. Good spot.
That looks like Venter. I think he spun round. That's not a good start to his day.
Absolute disaster.
He didn't have a good qualifying. He's going. He's managed to keep it going. He's going to join in the race, and he's got a lot of work to do from there.
Well, we said it's going to be hard to pass the Bentleys. And
look at Alex. Alex is definitely trying to find a way through on Darryl O'Young at the moment. O'Young has done a good job.
Yeah, he got past him, didn't he?
He did, to get his, you know, up into fourth position at the moment.
Also keeping an eye on Tim Sugden, just side by side with another of the Bentleys. Also looking forward to seeing where Jimmy Bruni can come through. He started way back. He, of all people, was given a penalty for exceeding track limits in the last corner as we come out of five and into six for the first time. Now you can start to see this undulating circuit and what a challenge this is as they come through the back part of the circuit towards the Redmond curve for the first time. It is Bentley that leads with Adelaide Fong.
Yeah, Adelaide Fong is doing a brilliant job out in front of the moment, Jonathan. He's actually driving this first lap like a qualifying lap. Look at the gap that he's managed to pull out on Carlo Van Damme at the moment. It's inch perfect, and that's what he does do well. He's had a lot of pole positions this year, and he can drive the car inch perfect, especially on new rubber. But after about two or three laps, the performance of these tyres is going to drop down quite a bit compared to what we're used to seeing at other circuits due to the nature of this circuit and how slippery and old the bitumen is.
Good composure though by Adley Fong. He was almost turned round. Sadly, fellow Bentley driver Venter was turned round in this famous first corner. But after the first lap, it is Fong and Van Damme chasing each other. Van Damme getting a good start in the second place. Marchie Lee with the lights. Sean Thong with the lights blazing. Here's another look at the start. First of all, keep an eye on Adelaide Fong leading the race. He gets a little nudge from the Lamborghini, but I think the Lamborghini was just, I don't think it was intended by any means. And then it was Richard Lyons, by the looks of things.
Yeah, Venter got turned around there, and unfortunately that's made his race very, very difficult.
Into five again, and Adelaide building on that lead at the moment.
Yeah, Adelaide is just really good. Just see the amount of grip he's getting at the moment. Good grip from the rear of his car, and definitely good drive. There's Venter, he's recovered, but he's about to be lapped.
Yeah. So I don't think he will be lapped, though, because he's got the pace to get ahead.
Assuming that the car hasn't been damaged.
That's true. I do feel sorry. They got caught out in the safety car incident in Thailand a few weeks ago at round 3 and 4. That really could pay because they had to leave the championship earlier in the year, and got a lot of work to do now, and this is not the start they wanted here. But it's Bentley, Team Absolute, in the GT3, getting very wide there and out of shape for a moment. But, gathers it all together. The Lamborghini is likewise in third position, chasing the Ferrari 458 of Carlo Van Damme. Liberati, the Italian, in the Lamborghini, started on the front row, now down in third. And Ouyang started very brightly, getting ahead of Alex Jung, the Malaysian, who now is up to fifth place. Rizzo and Liu, their car with Davide Rizzo in sixth place, the Italian, ahead of
Bentley. This could have been such a different race for Jimmy Bruni, who sits down in ninth position at the moment. Of course, his first time in the championship this year, and he actually did manage to qualify with a time that would have put him on the front row of the grid, but unfortunately exceeded the track limits by having all four wheels off the circuit on that fastest lap, and it was taken away from him. So unfortunately for him, you can see Keta Sauer, they're not happy.
Well, and he wouldn't be. I mean, of course, Keta won his first race with Bentley and their debut win in the series this time last year. And Keta, of course, raced at home. This is his home track. And Fuji, also another happy hunting ground. He'll be there in a few weeks' time. And Keta won there too last year. But now he's got a tall order to try and catch up. And as you can see, his car literally about to be lapped by the leader as they come out of the penultimate corner, or the penultimate hairpin before the last two corners.
Now, Carlo Van Damme, last time out, Brurem had a really fantastic first stint. He did drive really, really well and was right up there. But he's managed to keep that form here as well. We haven't really seen too much of that car throughout the weekend, but they've kept their nose clean. And the 458, the older of the Ferraris, is doing a very good job out there at the moment.
Talking a very good job. Strong just in a 131.1, fastest lap of the race, and is extending that lead now. The gap by 4 seconds already in the early stages. And the clock's counting down the middle of your screen there. 44 minutes to go. And of course, we will have a compulsory stop in just a few minutes' time.
Just to talk about the pit stop, we do have a pit stop because, we, of course, we have two drivers in these cars. And that pit stop will be 20 minutes after the race started. It's when the pit stop opens, and then the pit window is open for 10 minutes, and then it closes with 30 minutes left. So in that period is when the drivers have to pull in and change drivers.
So Keta Sauer getting ready, and of course the second drivers, if you will, the gentleman drivers, all kind of just concentrating on the race and seeing how their professional teammates do. And this is a good start by Liberati. He's right there on the Ferrari of Carlo Van Damme, and just kind of hounding him for now. Not bothered, Carlo. He's very experienced. But I think the pace of the Lamborghini was speaking both to Liberati and Amici just before the start of the race. Both happily confident. Liberati's father's here this weekend. He's watching on the roof with us earlier. And, I think enjoying this weekend. I think both drivers, they're young Italians. They've settled down and finding their way in this GT80 Championship.
Absolutely. They've been up there in most of the weekends. They've had opportunities to win in the past, but it hasn't come to fruition. I was thinking that we might see the Lamborghini further ahead and perhaps dicing up with Adelie Fong in the Bentley at the moment. I think that they wouldn't be too happy that they're caught behind Carlo Van Damme. And perhaps he's really struggling to get past. But look at Daryl Ouyang. He's having the best drive in the Porsche that he's had so far this year, in my opinion.
Well, funnily enough, both Ouyang and Young behind him, Alex Jung, excuse me, behind him, both on the 131s last time out. And so they are flying at the moment. Likewise, Jimmy Bruni, 131.9 last time out, quicker than the men in front of him. So we're keeping an eye on this battle for fourth place, because it's catching quickly to the battle in front of them for second place. And I think it won't be long. Perhaps even before the pit stop window, as we also look at where Davide Rizzo is in sixth place, because he too is not too far off. It's nicely bunching up together. Coming out of the corner there is Rizzo, just in the distance there. Back up the hill they come.
Of course, the lap record at the circuit was set by Andrea Caldarelli at 1:29.8. So they're just about 0.8 of a second off of that at the moment. But to be honest, with the lead that Adelie Fong's got in the absolute Bentley out front at the moment, I don't think that he'll be thinking about the lap record. He'll be just trying to ease the laps out. He's already got a 5-second lead over the pack behind.
I love talking to Adelie because he's so laid back and so honest. I said to him, what's your tactics? He said, just get through the first corner, hold off the Lamborghini, and then the rest is fine. I know the pace.
Look who's coming through. Look who's coming
nicely
through.
Done. And it is brilliantly overtaking. Jimmy Bruni overtakes fellow Ferrari man Davide Riso there. And the Italian in the all-Italian outfit. Dark gets through.
He's just moved his way up to sixth position there, and it's definitely a hard ask in a circuit like this when you start so far down the field to make his way through. But it was his fault that he ran off the track, therefore he's got a lot of hard work to do.
I know, and a rare mistake, if you will, from one of the best in GT racing worldwide, Jimmy Bruni. We are delighted to have him here. He is, without doubt, the number one Ferrari driver. Sadly, didn't have the best of Le Mans. They had an alternator problem, he and Caldarelli, and obviously racing for Clearwater Racing. And Mok Wen Sung, with Rob Bell and Kedesauer, had a fantastic Le Mans, finishing just off the podium and getting pole position in their category, and finishing, more importantly, the famous 24 Hours of Le Mans. So it's been a busy time, but an exciting time for Asian motorsport.
Just looking at Alex Jung at the moment, and I've got to say, in the Audi R8, he's looking very menacing on the back of Darrell O'Young.
Yes.
He tried to have a nip up into turn five this lap, and he's certainly looking for a way through.
Toy Biron Bakhti and Frank Yu waiting for their stint, and that'll be coming up very soon. We are 10 minutes into this race, and already we've had some real action, the major part being that the Bentleys were almost both turned around. Adelie Fong at the front, and Jonathan Bentner was spun around by the Interrush Porsche, and that has put pay to his hopes of a decent result, but he'll try to come through if he can. He's on good pace, is Jonathan the Aussie, but it's not easy. The real battle, though, is definitely here in fourth and fifth place between O'Young and Alex Jung of Malaysia. Darrell O'Young, of course, the former WTCC and Porsche Carrera Cup Asia man, and of course Alex Jung himself has also appeared in that championship.
There he goes,
he's nicely done. Oh, and he holds the breaking point, does he? Yes, nicely done by the Audi, and a good clean overtake by Alex Jung.
It looks a lot easier on the television than it does when you're out on the side of the track. There's not a lot of room there to nip up the inside, but a great move by Alex Jung, and I'm sure that his co-driver, Alex Au, will be waiting with anticipation to get into that car.
Well, we stood at this corner earlier in the weekend with Alex, because it's just behind the pits there, and he kind of walked up to see how his teammate was getting on, and just to see how he could see how the other cars were coming through that corner and what the form guide was. But he's looked a lot more laid back this weekend, a lot less furrowed in his brow, Alex.
Well, they've had, issues. If you remember, they had issues last time out in Bururam with reliability, so they didn't get a lot of running in the Audi, unfortunately, but of course the gearbox issues that they have been sorted out now, and you can see that now that he's been able to get a few laps under his belt, he's becoming very competitive in his class.
And of course, last time out in Thailand, it was Audi who won with Mark Chili, and of course Davide Riso and Anthony Liu winning for Ferrari. And that's opened up the championship nicely, because it was a Bentley Fest to start off with from Korea, and now everybody seemingly has had a chunk at it. Porsche perhaps are the surprise package, brand new car this year, but they've yet to really shine. And
they've had their chances. Richard Lyons was leading the race first time out in Korea, but he got taken out by the Lamborghini, so it's not as if they hadn't had their chances.
Go on, Jimmy.
Look at that. He is on a move, isn't he?
He is on a mission. Jimmy Bruni then, in the Ferrari, gets past the Porsche of Darrell O'Young.
Lap time-wise, just to keep you in the picture, he's lapping in the 30.8, the same pace as Adelie Fong out front. So Jimmy Bruni could have had the pace to run at the front, perhaps win this race.
Carlo Van Damme, meanwhile, in second place, doing a very good job of holding off Liberati. He's put a little bit of gap between him, 131.2 last time out. Liberati 131.5, so similar pace. And interesting, Von Kanat slips behind the Bentley, and I think that was an indication to say, get behind me, and I'll drag you around, my friend.
Well, either that or, you know, now there's another roadblock.
That's very true. Two Bentleys now can spread themselves out, but one is at the back, the other is leading this race. But I think they can drag each other a little bit and maybe get some good lap times now before this window opens.
Yeah, I think the last thing Jonathan Venter wanted to do out there was get in the way of his teammate and spoil the race for him. So it was the smartest move to do, to move over it and let him through.
It's interesting also, Fong and Kim in a very good position in terms of the pit stop times as well. We'll get into that as they start to come in, Steve. But obviously, after the success of Thailand, there's different times for each of the pit stops. Everybody comes in for a compulsory 75, but then there's added time depending on how successful they've been. Talking of success, that was almost disaster for Jimmy Bruni. That is, he caught up with Alex Jung.
He is definitely driving the wheels off that. There's
his teammate,
Mokwin Sun, of course. They're fresh back from Le Mans. They did some brilliant things over there.
Well, they were upset after qualifying, and I know that Jimmy Bruni had a very out-of-sorts kind of qualifying, A, for doing the track limits, but also they were concerned about their tyre pressures. Both drivers complaining that they just didn't have the tyre pressures right. The temperature did go up dramatically.
Here we
Here's another look at Bruni.
He's tried up the inside of Turn 5. Alex has closed the door. A little bit of a slide there on the exit for Bruni, but he didn't make that move stick. But I'm sure he's going to give it another crack this time around, because he's caught up to the back of Alex Ewan quite quickly. And it doesn't look like it's going to be in a turn one, though.
I'd say one thing, amazing. Maybe one of the most experienced and successful Asian drivers, I may add, that we've got in the series. Certainly got more races under his belt than most. But to be taking over the car from the mighty Jimmy Bruni is not the easiest of things to do, but it would be quite an honour.
Absolutely. He is used to it, though, isn't he?
Yes.
So, I mean, they have teamed up before in the past, so...
Mox has some pretty special teammates
over the years. When you actually, you know, when you go through his driver bio, you can see the quality of driver that he's driven with, and that's what makes him such a great driver himself.
Looking for a way past Jung and trying to get wide as possible with Alex, and he's... not letting him through at five this time. They go into six, and it's very tight here at Okayama in Japan. Lights blazing then for Sean Thong.
Good to see Sugden as well in the 98 Group M Porsche. They're having quite a good weekend. He's got a new team mate this weekend, the New Zealander Jono Lester.
Yeah, I know Jono. Good guy, and still young, still very fast. He's been in the Super Trofeo series of late, and of course has got a lot of experience of GT racing, and came up through Porsche, and definitely a very fast pedaler for sure, and I think the combination of he and Sutton has been a good one this weekend, and will prove to be as the weekend continues. Into turn one, still under pressure is Alex Jung, because Bruni's pushing down the laps, a 31-1 last time out.
30.5, the fastest lap of the race for Bruni, of course, and that is quicker than the leader, so he's certainly showing the skill that he's got in that 488 Ferrari.
Meanwhile, at the front, Adley Fong of Hong Kong, a 7.6 second lead heading towards the pit stops, and that's going to be ominous because there's a lot more time for some of the other drivers than the Fong-Kim combination, and so they should come out with an advantage. Here comes Bruni again. He's all over the back of the Audi. He jinks to the outside.
He's going to get him to go around the outside, but he's going to be poised beautifully
for
the inside.
Got his foot in, hasn't he? He's kept his foot in. Oh, he thought about it. The next obvious overtaking position would be Redmond coming up the hill, which is at the end of this small straight here. But it's again, it's going to be quite a brave move, and he looks as though he might go for it. Everybody watching on didn't quite pull it off. Up the hill they go.
A little bit of a slide there from the back of the Audi as well. Just
out of the Hobbs corner.
Tyre wear starting to come into play.
Incidentally, the corners named after famous sports car drivers from the UK, including the likes of Brian Redmond and David Hobbs. Oh, and very wide out of the last corner there. One place they've got to be careful exceeding track limits. We heard and saw that both Alex Jung and Bruni were penalties for exceeding those track limits, and they've got to be careful not to do it in the race itself. As we take a look at the all-gold Audi number five, now hooning in on the number 98, the Group M Porsche.
It amazes me the things that these drivers do in between. Sean Fong has been in Liverpool, of course, in the Golden Audi at the moment since Brewer M, passing university exams.
Of all places.
Yeah. Once again, Bruni's trying to look up the inside. He's placing himself. He's out in the slipstream, but I think he's too far behind this particular time. He's certainly under, putting Alex Jung under a lot of pressure. But Alex has been around, and he knows how to take the pressure, doesn't he? He's not going to let be muscled out of the way by Bruni.
Mark waits for his opportunity. And, yep, it's go, go, go from the girls. And just a reminder that after four rounds of the championship, this is round five. Liu and Davide Dizzo, after that great result in Thailand, are leading the way with 55 points. Jonathan Venter with work to do, quite clearly now, desperately trying to score some points this weekend. But from the back, that ain't going to be too easy. They're on 43 points. Marcelli and Sean Fong, who we've been watching, also trying to come through. They're on 41 points. And then Vuitton, with his new teammate, sixth place overall. Still a long way to go yet. Another race in Japan before we head to China for two rounds, one in Shanghai. And a lot of anticipation still to come from the 2016 GTA series. We're live worldwide here. And we welcome you to our coverage from Okayama.
The other thing that the drivers need to be careful of here, Jonathan, is the fact that a lot of the other circuits we've been to have been quite new, with a lot of runoff on the edge of the track, so they can use a lot of... they can run their wheels off the edge, but here at this Okayama circuit, it's so worn that they have to be really careful that they don't puncture their tyres, because if they actually get the whole wheel off on some of the corners, there's a big step, a big drop-off, and that's why we're seeing not as much of the track used as you might see at some of the more modern circuits.
Getting ever closer to the pit stop window. 30 minutes remaining, 14 minutes into this race. And some good battles throughout. It'll change the dimension again, though, as Carlo Van Damme still in second place and almost 8 seconds down on the leader, Fong, who's putting in some really good lap times. His last time at 131.3. And I think really enjoying the fact that he made a really good start, got a little nudge, but kept his concentration. It could have all come to nothing. He kept his concentration, and as soon as he got the lead, he started to pull away. The attack from Lamborghini didn't really come to anything. They continue to be in third place, some 9 seconds adrift.
Right, Jonathan, the pit stop window is now open. So we may see some of the teams come in and change drivers. So the 10-minute window is now open.
We head through Dickie Atwood corner at the bottom of the circuit and then climb back up the hill for the longest straight here. They get up to speeds of about 237 kilometers per hour here, up to sixth gear, and then diving down into the hairpin at about 70 through here.
Yeah, there's a lot of G-force, of course, involved. 1.5 Gs they're pulling in a lot of these corners. Downforce at this circuit, not as critical as some of the higher speed circuits. Of course, the top speed attained here is about the 235 to 240 mark from these cars, which is lower than we've seen. So downforce not as critical here. So the setup becomes a lot more critical to get that mechanical grip out of the car.
Well, Jimmy Bruni doing an excellent job, and look at the pressure he's already putting on here. Up to fifth place, having started pretty much at the back and now all over the back.
Yeah, they pulled the Lamborghini in. They pulled the Hurricane in, haven't they? Look at Alex go. Alex Jung, he's definitely been pressured, but that pressure has helped them rein back the Lamborghini.
No one's stopping just yet. Actually, one of the Bentleys, and it is Venter who comes in. He's the first.
Yeah, the reason for that, of course, is he had that spin on the first lap. He must have some sort of slight damage, but he needs to come in and get that sorted out. He may have flat-spotted one of the tyres for sure, so we may see some tyres be changed.
The only solace, I suppose, is that they've got a relatively short time, 88 seconds.
They do, yeah. What they have got is an 88-second pit stop, of course. That is 75 seconds plus their 13 seconds, which they get for being a silver-silver driver combination.
There are several.
There's six silver total, yeah. Driver combinations. every one of those six gets 13 seconds added on to the 75 compulsory pit stop time for everybody.
All right, well, given that we are going to start to see these all now shuttle through, who's got the biggest compensation? Who's going to be in the pits the longest?
Well, the people that will be, have the biggest compensation, of course, is Rizzo and Lou in the BBT Ferrari. The reason for that is that they won last time out and they've had some pretty good results. So they will stop for 98 seconds.
Also notice that the Audi of Thong is in, and that means that Marchi Lee, and we know what he can do, will be out and about. Another pit stop. This time it's the Lamborghini. So they're shuffling through now, and the excitement that is GT Asia really starting to unfold here. Round five, and this is where the action, and this is where the teams come into play, because get this right, you can be on the podium. Get it wrong, and it's the end of your day. Here's another look at Bruni attacking Alex Jung, and a successful one at that, at turn five.
Yeah, he nipped up the inside. I'm not surprised to see Liberati come in early, though, because he was really struggling there towards the end of that race. His lap times had dropped off a bit where the other guys had actually sped up. Both Bruni and Jung were in the 30s, about 1 second quicker. There's a compensation time of 91 seconds for the Ferrari. And, of course, the reasoning for that is they're a silver-silver combination, and they also have an accumulated compensation time of 3 seconds from the results that they've received as well. Because if you finish on the podium here, you do get a penalty in seconds to add on to the time.
Really looking forward to see what Kenesawa can do, because of course he won here last time. The Japanese racing at home as the sun comes out here in Okayama, and he's at the wheel and probably pretty angry because this wasn't the start to the weekend that Keta wanted. Of course, he had to miss Thailand. He too went and drove at Le Mans. So he is absolutely hungry. I spoke to him this morning. He's typical Sauer style. Really looking forward. Albora getting excited for his team, Lamborghini. And they are watching on as they go through and get ready to put Amici in the car. And he's already in and about to go. Here he goes.
The other critical thing to mention about these pit stops, Jonathan, is that 75 seconds they need to, or whatever the pit stop time is, the total time is that they need to achieve inside the pits, they need to do that. If they go through, if they've got a 98 second pit stop penalty and they go through at 99, they get a drive-through penalty, and we saw that at Buriram last time out. So everyone's will be extra careful to make sure that they don't leave that pit box early. If they do, expect to see some drive-through penalties.
Yeah, it's absolutely critical, as out comes the Ferrari.
Now, Anthony Liu drove brilliantly last time at Buriram. I'm really interested to see what he can do in the BBT Ferrari here today.
To be fair, Steve, I don't think I've seen a bad drive in the last year from Anthony. He's been the sensation in my mind of GT Asia, the young man from Shanghai. Here comes the Bentley. Vuitton will be at the wheel. And here's your leader, yet to pit. Fong will be handing the car over to the young South Korean, Andrew Kim. Has he given him the leeway? I think at 10 seconds he has. It's been a good run by Adley Fong, but we expected it.
Well, the good news for them is, because they haven't had such a good run recently, Jonathan, is that they don't have any compensation times added to their pit stop of 75 seconds, except for the fact that they're a silver No, they don't. They have a 75-second pit stop, so it's going to be really good for them.
Yeah, and it's not a surprise to see Fong continuing to circulate. They're usually the professional, the faster drivers tend to stay out as long as the window's open, just so they can get as many laps in. And often, there's traffic around, especially when there's a lot of pit stops being taken. It gives the driver out front a little bit more time, maybe to put in some very quick laps and give the best possible chance for his teammate.
Absolutely. And I mean, when you're Adley Fong, gold driver, that's what you would do. You would stay out there, and Andrew Kim with the bronze. And there's Bruni now, right in the back of Carlo Van Damme.
I know, this is great watching this. Carlo Van Damme of Holland defending Jimmy Bruni. One in a 4.58, the other in the newer turbocharged 4.88. Carlo Van Damme was talking to him about this circuit. He loves this place. He's won here several occasions. In fact, in Formula 3, back in his Japanese days of Japanese Formula 3, he was a big champion in his early days here and he loves this track.
Quite different, the 458 and the 488 Ferrari, of course. The 488's fitted with turbochargers, but it's got more downforce as well, which, even though it's got a more, theoretically, a more powerful car, it's slightly slower than the 458 in a straight line, but it definitely has better handling capabilities and it's able to get the power down. So that's the difference between the 458, the older car that's been around once so much. Here's Adelie Fong with a, he's coming with a 10-second lead. That's a great drive by him.
Here comes the leader then, into the pit stop, down. As you can see, the pit in timing. And as soon as that horn goes up, he knows he's got to keep to the limited time and speed. And in he comes, hits his marks, nicely done.
This is going to work out fantastically for these guys. As long as Andrew Kim can keep up a reasonably good pace, they're sitting in the box seat for this weight race at the moment. 75 seconds pit stop time for these guys.
Adelie Fong, one of the busiest men in town. He's been racing in the States in this same team, and to much effect too, on the podium last time out. He'll be back in a few weeks' time racing again. And this is side-by-side stuff. Carlo Van Damme trying desperately to hold off the Italian Jimmy Bruni. They're wheel-to-wheel in the two Ferraris. Great action here from Okuyama, and look at this, Bruni tucks himself behind.
Carlo Van Damme not leaving him too much room on the outside of the track there, and brakes very, very late.
I think he's enjoying this, is Carlo.
Do you think so? You think he's being monstered by one of the best?
Yeah, and defending and holding his own, that's why. Meanwhile, Kurosawa just behind them. Through the midsection of this circuit. Not a lot of places to overtake, and we're seeing it. And we're seeing the example of that as out comes the number seven. Andrew Kim at the wheel now, leads this race. 21 minutes to go. And once now everybody has shuffled through, we'll get a good idea to see what battles will ensue in the closing stages of this round five. In comes the big battle between Carlo Van Damme and Jimmy Bruni. The two Ferraris both in, and that pretty much finishes off the pit stops.
That is pretty good timing, to be honest, because if they'd have stayed out much longer, that pit window would have closed and then they would have been in big, big trouble. But they've come in at the absolute last minute, which is exactly what you would need to do. Pity Berhan Bakdi will be getting into the car now. Van Damme out. Good job by him.
Yeah, no question. That was a good run by Carlo. And yeah, he's been doing a bit of karting back in Bangkok, and spends a lot of his time in Thailand at the moment, as Carlo, but Japan has been a great and happy hunting ground for him over the years. Spent most of his career, the Dutchman over here.
It's going to be good to see Mok Wing Sung out on track as well. Of course, his first race back in Asia since racing in Le Mans.
Yeah, fantastic result for them. First time at the famous 24 Hours, spoke to him about it, and he said it was almost surreal. He couldn't believe that he was there with all the good and the great, so to speak, and it was a big achievement really for Arj and the team to be there and to do so well. Got pole position with Rob Bell, and then were fighting for the podium throughout the 24 Hours and finish, more importantly, just off the podium. But I think a finish, as you well know from your motorcycle days at Le Mans, is enough for anybody. Just getting around 24 Hours is brilliant.
Yeah, it's a very emotional thing, but
and I may add, you won it.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what though, Jonathan, the battle continues between the two Ferraris. Mok Wing Sung is out on track now, of course, and the Singer car is just in front of them.
So we are looking at Andrew Kim as he goes through to the outward corner here at Okuyama and back up the hill and back down the long straight. Berhan Bakdi, pity Berhan Bakdi in the Singer Ferrari. We'll try to chase him down.
This is a very critical.
That was a moment.
Yeah, Andre Amici in the car now, of course. It's going to be interesting to see what he can do, but the battle continues between these two guys. Of course, Darryl O'Young out of the car, and Toy Berhan Bakdi taking over the VLT Porsche.
It's been an eventful weekend for Toy. He had a moment, should we put it that way, where he spun round in one of the practices leading up to this first race on the last corner and almost got collected by a Bentley, but he's just got past Lamborghini, as Amici makes it nice and clear through there. Nicely done.
Yeah, this is the critical part of the race, just after the pit stops when the new drivers come into the car, and that they really have to be able to just switch their brain off from sitting in the pit to their absolute fastest lap speeds when they get in the car for the first time. It's a really difficult to do, to go from doing nothing to get out there and do that lap speed. You can't warm up. You've just got to do the job.
Now, let's start comparing the times. Kim crosses the line with a 133.7. Bit of back to 137.4. Everybody just getting up to speed. But that was a good lap by Kim, because no one actually is anywhere close.
No, but that was his second flying lap. So I expect to see Buren Bakhti and the other guys get a lot closer this next time round. So he's already had two laps out there. Adley Fong come in a lap earlier.
Keeping an eye also on Alex Al, who's in fourth position. Alex Jung putting in a very good stint in the first stint to hold on to fourth place. And certainly Mok Wen Sung in a great position, currently in third. As we take a look at the leader coming out of five and into six. The Bentley looks so... It's interesting, actually. I didn't think this circuit, even despite the results, I kind of put it down to Kitasawa last year. Andy Susek was on pole. But it doesn't seem that the Bentley would suit a track like this. You'd think perhaps more towards the Audi or the Ferrari, but the Bentley's been brilliant around here.
Yeah, I mean, the reason for that, of course, it's got that beautiful 4-litre V8 engine with a twin turbo that just,
and
I mean, listen to it. It just gets the grunt onto the ground.
But it does win my mark for the top sounding car.
On top of that, it also is excellent in the braking area and tipping in. It's got the engine mounted in the front, and this track everybody's complaining about front grip, so of course having the engine in the front of the car actually helps with more weight on the front, get steering grip. So there's a lot of reasons why the Bentley could be so successful.
Yeah, it's interesting
circuit.
You bring that. Audi were complaining, several of the Audi drivers were complaining just about that fact, about trying to get
the other most successful car here, of course, is the Aston Martin, which is another front-engined V12 machine. So, that configuration works well around this Okiyama circuit, especially with these harder SL9 Michelin Sleeks that we run in the series.
Richard Lyons takes a breather. Got a little bit of a sweat on after his stint, but gets a bit of praise from his engineer, why not? So, the order is Kim, Biron Bakhti, Bentley versus Ferrari. As through goes the number 9. Utegon makes up a place on Frank Yu. Frank Yu now at the wheel of this Porsche. They dropped a little bit of weight, but it didn't seem to help the Porsche this weekend.
No, with the BOP, of course, we have a balanced performance, which evens the cars up. If there's, if it looks like there's a car that's not competing as well as the others, they free up the restrictions on the car. The Porsche this weekend's carrying less weight, but it's also got a more open inlet tract by reducing the size of the restrictor, so there's bigger holes. It can get more air in. It is 8 horsepower better off. But
that's not enough.
Well, when you speak to the guys in the know, the straight line speed of the Porsche is actually very good. They just need to work more on the handling at this circuit at least.
Well, of course, it is a brand new car this season, still developing it, and the BOP boys have done a brilliant job. Actually, I couldn't believe the top 10 were split between less than a second. That tells you everything you need to know about how close things are. Now, Marchi Lee on the march here. Spoke to him at lunchtime. He's such a character, Marchi. And we're looking at him now on track as he chases down another of the brand new Group M Porsches. And it's Jono Lester at the wheel. He gives him a little indication that he wants by. And Jono says, yeah, thanks for letting me know, but I'm not really interested. I'm racing too, my friend.
Yeah, this is Jono's first race in a Porsche for quite a while, isn't it?
Yeah, and I'm really excited to have him on board. He is a quick guy. It was interesting to hear him in the driver's briefing making some very pertinent questioning about how he can, what he can do, what he can't do. He's here to race.
He's a very confident young fella.
Yeah, good guy. And again, another one of these Kiwis that comes out of nowhere. Earl Bamber and Brendan Hartley. It's a golden era for Kiwi racing at the moment, and they just keep producing them brilliantly. And they're right at the top of the game. Van der Drift, of course, more recently last year in Porsche himself. And here's another look at this battle. And Marchi has caught back up to it, and that's why Jono wanted past Biron Bakhti, and they both get past, but held up for a moment there, and that's why I think Marchi was able to start to put a charge on.
Yeah, Biren Bhakdi, of course, we mentioned it earlier, but he's been off track this weekend already, so probably just needs to build that confidence up again in the Porsche. Jono Lester's had no such problems, and he's keen as mustard. There's Alex Young, great drive by him.
Yeah, I'm pretty impressed, and as you can see from his demeanour, he's looking a lot happier than he has in the past. Well, okay, thanks, Alex, just proving it. Ooh, that was a little wide there by the Lamborghini.
Well, we don't have to look at that. It's a steward's job.
Yeah, but I'm just making an observation. That is the one corner that everybody has been culprit to, and the stewards were making sure that that was a place that everybody does keep into line there. Anyway, let's find out.
Pity Biren.
Currently in fifth place.
Pity Biren Bhakdi, of course, with Carlo Van Damme in the Singer Motorsport team, has a drive-through penalty. They've received a drive-through penalty, Jonathan. Now, there's... Yeah, it's
pit lane speed limiter. That's what it is.
Yeah. Okay. They've. Yeah. It's definitely an issue with the pit lane speed. I think he's perhaps taken the speed limiter off a bit too early, or whatever.
So with 12 minutes to go in this race, Kim still leads by just over 9.5 seconds, or just under 9.5 seconds, over Pity Biren Bhakdi. The combination of Bruni and Mock continues along in third position. And then out and Young, as in comes Biren Bhakdi to take that penalty. And this is going to take, we'll see him anyway, agonizingly long time for him. It had been a good, bright start to the day. You saw Carlo Van Damme expression there.
There's that drive-through penalty.
Yeah. Good officiating as always in Japan. They are racing. A lot of categories here involved this weekend. A lot of different styles of cars. A lot of fans enjoying getting their autographs from the big boys here in GT Asia as well, especially the likes of Kitasawa.
Alex Howe, of course, in the Audi R8 at the moment, just behind Mok Weng Sung. Everybody starting to get up to speed now. Most of these guys are a bit slower than they have been. They're in the 32s. Of course, we saw some 30s at the start of the race. But the man coming through the pack is, of course, in sixth position, is Lester. He's doing a great job in the Group M Porsche at the moment.
Yeah, very good indeed. It's been a good run, to say it's his first weekend. He and Sugden, a good combination.
If there's one man that would be used to going fast on the first lap of a race at the moment, because he's just been doing it for the last 24 hours, you'd think it'd be Mok Weng Sung.
Yeah. Well, he's certainly up to speed, that's for sure. Really enjoyed his outing in Le Mans. He said never done so much preparation than he needed to do, because it really was quite an arduous experience, just being in France and you go through all the media and the hoopla that is the Le Mans 24 hours is enough for anyone. But they did it, and Clearwater Racing doing a very, very good job indeed. Less than 10 minutes to go. What has been an intriguing start to our weekend of GTA racing from Okayama. Alex Young doing a very good job for Audi, for the Phoenix team.
Well, you know what this is about. This isn't just any old battle. This is the battle for second and third in the race.
Yes, absolutely.
So it's pretty critical. Alex Howe has got a really good opportunity. I'm sure that Alex Jung in the pits at the moment has got his fingers crossed. He's menacing the back of Mok Weng Sung at the moment, but just can't seem to find a way through. And if anything, it looks like Mok may have just pulled out again. Oh,
that was a little ambitious. Oh! And that is a disaster for Mok. I cannot believe that really was not a good move by Alex Howe, and you can see by the expression on Alex Jung's face, that was not really on at all, at any point.
Oh, he just tried to nip up the inside there, but there was no way that was going to happen.
Too far back.
Yeah, he's come from a long way back. He's
to be fair, the door was slightly open, but really, come on.
He'd overcommitted. There was nothing he could do about it. His Mok has turned in. He stalled the car there. You can see the car stalled. Let's hope that he can get it restarted with 8 minutes to go. If he can't, he's going to have a safety car. So there he is. For now, he's in second position, but I wouldn't be surprised if that goes to the stewards if there's some sort of penalty involved with that.
Saw Amici flashing by, just getting past. There he is, the Bentley.
Which, of course, that puts Amici up into third place at the moment. So that's another good result for the Lamborghini.
Flying up there as the battles continue.
Well, this is a part of the race where everyone needs to get serious.
Getting down to the closing stages. Round five of GT Asia. Jonathan Green and Steve Martin bringing you the action from Okayama Circuit. And there's been plenty of it as the number 37. Whoa. Chinese entry from Shanghai. The BBT boys are on the move.
Whoa.
Now that's what I call being dusted up.
Yeah, well, Anthony Liu is not afraid to have a go. Simple as that.
No, he certainly did a good job. And then Vuittikorn, of course, went up the inside. So a great overtaking manoeuvre there by both of those GT3 cars on the Porsche.
And at turn four, Liu goes wide, and this is a chance for the Bentley. He tucks himself behind the Ferrari, and as they head down towards turn five, everybody's got the drag race on, trying to get a little bit of a slipstream. It's Ferrari, Bentley and Porsche here in Japan. Great racing. Down to turn five. Out comes the VLT Porsche. Oh! And again, same turn, same incident. Not quite as cut and dry this time, because they were all racing for the same piece of asphalt. But who would you say is to blame for that one, Steve?
Yeah, I mean, that looks pretty much like a racing incident there. But once again...
The trouble is, he stalled it in the middle of the track.
He has. With 6 minutes left, he should be able to restart it. But that's not one of the best positions you need to be in, because it's in quite a bit of a blind spot there. Oh! He's got it going again.
Well, Vuittikorn manages to get it going in the Bentley, but that turn five, as it always is here at Okayama.
Let's analyse it. Up the inside goes the Porsche. Can't get through. Gets turned around by Biren Bakdi.
I mean, I'd say racing incident.
My word! That's a racing incident.
That's a big, big crash for...
Well, let's just see what's happened. That could have been some sort of mechanical failure. That's from being turned around.
That's amazing, actually. You wouldn't have thought.
No, it's because he's taken that. You can see there issue. He's taken the. He's taken a hit to the right rear of the car, and he's lost the wheel. That's the end of the race for that Bentley, I'm afraid.
I'm afraid it is. And there's also a lot of debris on track as they watch on at Bentley. And
That was a big, big impact.
What a race!
Yeah.
Round five then of the series, 2016. The Bentley sadly pulls off to the side. The yellow flag is waved. And as we come down to the last 5 minutes of this race, car number nine on the Vuittikorn of Thailand is out. Meanwhile, Audi and Lamborghini head to head.
Amici now, you've got to... Who would you have your money on now, Jonathan?
Amici, yeah. I would. To be fair, Au's been good, but I think just in the way of we've seen these two young Italians at Lamborghini race in the last few rounds, I definitely put my money on an overtake by the Lamborghini Huracan. Another new car this year.
Yeah, we've got quite a few new cars. We've got two of them, of course, the Audi R8 and the Lamborghini Huracan, the Porsche, another new one. Good to see, of course, a new car to the series for this year, the Aston Martin, which was so predominant, the championship winner last year, back as well with the Australian team.
Yeah, and they're looking to stick around as well, aren't they?
Yes, definitely. They look like they're going to be at Fuji in a couple of weeks' time, which is a favourite hunting ground for Andrew Medecki, part owner of that team.
And of course George, so father-son combination working together.
Now, that Lamborghini has been in a few incidences this year so far. This track looks like it's a place where if you're going to overtake, there's a chance you're going to have an incident. It's going to have to be very smooth. You just see the drift that he got off the back of these things.
Well, Amici was explaining before the race started that actually this section of the track is his favourite. This is where the car is really dialed in, especially up the hill here. We watched it yesterday as it got out of shape through here. And these last two corners, this is really what he favours. So,
do you know when he told me that, though, what I thought? I thought, well, that's all well and good, but this is the most difficult part of the circuit to overtake on.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're fast there, but he's held up by Alex Au at the moment, it's going to be to no avail. He needs to be fast into turn five.
Another lap completed then. Lap time's dropping off a little. Kim doing a 1:33.9, but still with a big lead over Alex Au. Yes. Second place, this is that battle. And, of course, third place, Amici. So it's starting to line up a little bit. Leicester's now joined it in fourth position. Jono Leicester putting in a great stint here. His last lap, a 132.8. As you can see, he's just behind. As they fly through the dust, he's now got the lights blazing on that Group M Porsche.
You know what? It's not out of the question that Leicester could put himself on the podium here.
He well could. And I think it would be a big enough a surprise for the Lamborghini. He's had his eyes fixated on the Audi for the last few laps. And I think it might change just a moment from now.
Yeah, lap time's certainly a lot slower in this second stint.
Part two of the Ferrari battle.
Yeah, the 458 still in front of the 488. But if we know Anthony Liu, he doesn't like hanging around, does he? He's definitely going to have a go at the Singer car with Mirren back the inside.
And that's a battle for seventh and eighth position. And as you can see, Liu's time in the last few laps significantly quicker.
Yeah, I mean, Liu definitely, he's a class driver. He's caught up some massive amounts of ground on the number 12 car. It looks like that Bentley's there to stay until the end of the race. Footy Corn's car.
Anthony Liu's teammate, David Edizo, racing in Europe in the break between rounds, getting on the podium. Black Pat series. Whoa, and out of shape goes the number 12, and that is all that Liu will need. And I would have said it's only a matter of time as he got onto the main straight again. Good drive out of the last corner is all he'll need. And here is that last corner. And with less than 2 minutes to go now, onto the main straight. Time running out here in round five. Kim leads this race. The combination of pole position man Adelie Fong, as here comes the number 37 BBT Ferrari up the inside of turn one. And that, nicely done.
That is a nice clean move. Beautifully, just up the inside, but he's still got Mock to contend with in front of him. Let's hope that Mock doesn't get in the way of this great battle.
Meanwhile, Jono Leicester in the number 98.
He's going to have a go, isn't he?
Of course he is.
Round the outside, look at him under brakes. He's definitely got the pace under brakes. If he can do that up the inside on the next lap round, because we've probably got about one lap left until this 50-minute race ends. He's got one more opportunity to do that, Jonathan.
Great racing. Leicester currently in fourth position, but looking for a podium here.
Oh, talk about pressure. What about Alex Au and the R8 Audi in front at the moment? He's certainly feeling the pressure.
Here comes the leader. And 53 seconds left to go. He crosses the line for another lap, the number 7, Bentley. Bentley, of course, winners here at the hands of Keter Sauer last time out. Time last year, and this time it's going to be Fong and Kim heading home.
A great job by Andrew Kim too. He stayed out of trouble. He's doing a good job. But here we go. Look at the Lamborghini pulled out of the slipstream.
Side by side with the
he's
Audi.
Through.
And he is through. And now Leicester will look for a way as well. Time running out. This could be it. Leicester desperate to get past, but it's the Lamborghini Hurricane of Amici.
Porsche.
Nicely done.
Porsche hasn't had a podium in this championship this year yet.
It's
with
a good
the
point.
New car.
It's a good point. And in fact, Tim Sugden, of course, having a few years off from racing, the former Porsche Carrera Cup Asia champion from 2007, and teaming up with several different drivers. But Jono Leicester getting the nod this weekend and playing his role brilliantly. Here he comes on the Audi. They're side by side down the back straight here.
You got a great drive up the inside. Took a nice tight turn through turn four, and he's through.
Nicely done. Into turn five there. Closing stages of round five, but Amici putting down the hammer now. As the clock's ticked down now to zero. Checkered flag awaits then. What a race this has been. Some sad news for Bentley. For Venter, turn round, and Vudekorn, as you can see, strewn out on the track. But for this Bentley of Adelie Fong and Andrew Kim, it's been a great round five, and there's the checkered flag as Kim takes the checkered flag for a win for Bentley, and Adelie Fong and the team can be well delighted. It was a great first stint from the Hong Kong driver, cool as a cucumber at the start. Amici does a very good job of holding on. Leicester puts in a great debut performance.
That, Jonathan, was what I call a GT3 race. Definitely a lot of action there. But didn't the guys that won the race, Andrew Kim and Adelie Fong, just they did what they do best. Adelie led off the line, got a clean run, left everybody for dead, kept his nose clean, looked after the car, brought it back in, and Andrew Kim finished the job off brilliantly.
And a bit of relief look on Natalie Fong. Well, Nina there?
He won't have it so easy in round six because he will have an extra penalty time added, of course, for the win. An extra 10 seconds.
Yeah, worth considering. Big drama for the pen with the wheel.
Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of good action in that race. And, you know, of course, the 98 Group M Porsche getting the first podium for Porsche as well.
And there's Liberati. Thumbs up from him.
Yep, second spot for them in the Hurricane.
And the FFF Racing team, Alcora there, the team manager in the white shirt. They can be well pleased with that. It's a good result. And, you know, I was talking to them this morning, and it's slowly catching. They've got two young Italian drivers, and they're still finding their way here in Asia. I mean, to be fair, Liberati's already had much success here in the Super Trofeo series, so, and was last year's champion, so they know what they're doing. Here's the result then. The Bentley Team Absolute with the win ahead of the FFF Racing Team by ACM Lamborghini. And then it's the Group M Racing Porsche in third place. Jono Lester doing a really, really good job. And Phoenix Racing Asia in the Audi taking fourth place. And likewise in fifth. Matt Stone Motorsport and the Aston Martin returning to the fold for this round, but not with the success they wanted. But I think it puts a benchmark down to what they have to do. They can see, I was talking to George this morning and saying that they're really impressed at just how competitive this series is. You can't just walk in here and
have a holiday.
No.
You've got to be able to drive the car to make it work.
And you see the hashtag Get Well Soon Andrew. Andrew Palmer, of course, the young American 21-year-old who was involved in an incident while racing in the States. And we do wish him well because we want to see him back here in Asia. And Natalie Fong will be heading back to the States to race for Bentley. But look at him. He's all about it, isn't he? He's helping Paddy Roberts and the team get the car where it needs to be. Here's another look then at the result. Fong and Kim with the victory for Bentley. Lamborghini second with Liberati and Amici. Sugden and Lester. That is a fantastic result for Porsche. Their first of the year. And certainly Tim Sugden's, who's been the constant. And Lester making his debut. Really good stuff for Jono, the Kiwi. And then Young and Au in fourth position. Thong and Lee fifth. Rizzo and Liu in sixth place, Van Dam Birumbakhti in sixth, and Bruni and Mock taking eighth position.
You know what? I also want to say a great result for the South Korean Andrew Kim.
It is.
It's his first win at GT3 Asia.
Really, really impressive, and it couldn't come at a better time. I mean, I think Adelie, obviously, every time we look at him, he's been a development driver in Formula One. He's had a lot of success over the years, in both single seaters and, of course, now in GTs, and still a youngster, really. But he is the man to watch, and I think Andrew Kim's got his work cut out.
Well, he has, but that's the thing that I like about this Pro-Am racing is the fact that who better to learn off than your teammate,
exactly,
Adelie Fong? You know, he's definitely a great driver with a lot of experience in a lot of different cars. And he's not scared to get out there and have a bit of a help and push the car to the to the winner's podium.
I don't know if it's out of fuel or what, but it's certainly needing some manpower, the Bentley. Matter and the rest of the team. Meanwhile,
bit of work.
Lutikorn checks out the damage to three wheels on his wagon.
Yeah, we might not have heard the last of this yet. He's probably not too happy about that.
Yeah, it's going to be a long night of getting that all fixed up, I'm sure. And Fudicorn's tail was high after a good race weekend at home in Thailand. And coming in with a new, fast Bentley driver from Germany in Christian Johns. And, disappointment. And really looking forward to what should have been a big day for them. And here's what happened. They say they were turned around. It was amazing, actually, that it did that much damage in that. Brief incident.
It doesn't take much. I mean, you've only got to shatter the bolts, and you can just see their bits and pieces flying everywhere that hold that shaft in place. And there's nothing else that holds that in. So a lot of work to be done by Bentley tonight.
So very differing stories there. The elation for the number. Well, let's go down. And Sean Hazelwood's got our winner, Adley Fong of Hong Kong. And here is the two winners, Adley Fong.
Adley Fong, nice result, victory again, and it looked pretty easy for you from where we sat.
Thanks. Was not easy. It's never easy to get a win. Finally, it's the first win of the year for me. So yeah, really emotional. Andrew did put in a great stint at the end just to keep on the black stuff, and then everyone else was making the mistakes. So yeah, just tried to keep my head in it, get clear in turn one, and then just try to pull a gap, hand it to Andrew, and we did what we needed to do today.
Andrew, great result for you. It looked like hard work.
Yeah, it was quite hard, and actually it's my first victory for my racing, so I'm really happy. And also thanks to the team, and Adley told me tons of things, so I love to drive with him, and yeah, it was quite a bit hard, but yeah, it was okay, actually. Not that hard for me. Yeah, thanks.
Congratulations, guys. Well done.
A really very telling interview there. Andrew Kim obviously just realizing, you know, Adley Fong, first win of the year, but he had two last year as he was running, you know, a very successful season for him, and so he's used to it. But first time, and you can see the delight for Andrew Kim. Here's the championship points then. Rizzo and Liu moving to 63 points and holding on to that lead. But Kim and Fong now moving up the board. They've got 54 points, as has Eduardo Liberati and his teammate Andrea Amici. The two Italians right there, and it's how close it is. And then there's just 4 points back to Marchili and his teammate Sean Thong on 50. So it's really hotting up nicely. A little further down, more disappointment really for Jonathan Venter, the Australian, with 44 points. Vuitekorn, likewise, no points for him after a DNF. And Sauer with work to do down in 13th position. We're not used to seeing him that far down. Sugden coming up the board now with 34 points. Disappointment so far for the Frank Yu, Richard Lyons combination that promised so much at the beginning of the season. And we really thought that this could be a potent force. But it's just not played out that way so far for the brand new Porsche. And Richard Lyons down in 21st place. Jimmy Bruni coming in this weekend, but he too not having the best of it, or easiest of starts to the weekend after that qualifying disappointment. But more to come, I'm sure, from the next round of GT Asia, which will be taking place tomorrow. And there is the possibility, Steve, of rain. And I know Richard Lyons, who I was just talking about, was doing a little rain dance last night.
Yeah, I'm sure the guys that drive in Europe some of the time have got a lot of wet weather experience. But I'll tell you what, it rains a lot in Asia too. So it's going to be interesting to see how that changes the outcome of the situation tomorrow. But one thing's for sure, definitely in the wet, we're going to see a different race altogether. A
couple of highlights for me from round five. Jimmy Bruni scything his way through, and I think actually a fantastic first win for Andrew Kim, keeping his head, getting that 10-second lead. Obviously, we expect that kind of stint from Adley Fong, but it's another thing to hold on to that pressure.
Absolutely. I agree with you, Andrew Kim. And for me, the other highlight was the Group M Porsche.
Yes.
Getting on the podium for the first time, having to come through the pack. They're the underdogs, but they did a good job and worked their way through.
Yeah, very impressive. Like I said, Tim, who has had much success, the Englishman, in Asia before, but coming back to race in Asia for the first time in a few years this season. So great to see them on the podium finally in the brand new Porsche, and also great to see the man alongside him. Here they are, Jono Lester, 26-year-old from New Zealand, and his debut in the series. So what a great way to start.
Absolutely. Tim Sugden will be stoked to be up there with him.
And we know you're watching. Yeah, and we know you're watching in Italy, because we've heard emissaries already that the Lamborghini boys were tuning in, and they usually do, to see how these two youngsters from Italy get on, and they've done the business today. Liberati and Amici.
Oggi and a fatto bene.
Si. But all smiles once again for Bentley. They took the debut win here last year, and they've done it again in the hands of Adley Fong and Andrew Kim. This combination is going to be potent for sure. I think now that Kim is up to speed, and like he says, getting a lot of good help and education, if you will, from Adley. And I think it's going to be a very interesting season from here on in. We're kind of halfway, we're getting to the halfway point of the season tomorrow. And it's good to see Porsche starting to make a way and get into this scene because we expected them to be, or we expect all of them to be, there or thereabouts. But Porsche just haven't really shown this season. And now, finally, the Group M Porsche is all smiles, as you can see.
The thing that amazes me, Jonathan, is the championship. I mean, there's only 10 points covering, you know, a whole group of guys halfway through the championship. It means it must be the right formula.
Well, we went all the way to Buriram last year, last October, when Daryl O'Young took the title. He, too, racing for Porsche this year, back to Porsche. And he has had a disappointing start to his year, too. But you can expect them to come forward, too, as will Frank Yu and Richard Lyons. So, yeah, it's all hotting up nicely in many ways. Bentley, though, Team Absolute. Doesn't matter what continent they're racing on. Adelaide's getting pretty used to being on the podium this year. Been a good season, 2016, so far. And Okuyama throwing up some great racing for round five. And there's your podium. Fong and Kim, Liberati and Amici to your left, and Sugden and Lester. Well, more racing to come from the famous Okuyama circuit. Is there rain going to come? Well, we'll find out tomorrow afternoon. And thanks to Steve Martin. We've enjoyed watching round five, and all hats off to the combination for Bentley and Adley Fong, who took the first stint from pole position. Was almost turned around, but managed to hold on and then give the car back to Andrew Kim, who marched on to his first victory in GT Asia. We'll be back tomorrow with more action from round six.